All right, welcome everybody. So today we're gonna be interviewing Erik Olson. I'll do some video after and just show you his great space that he has to work in so we can all be terribly jealous of it and show you some of the work he's doing. You can see some of the work behind us that he's doing, and we're just gonna get to know him a little bit. I've already had the pleasure of chatting with him a bit, so it's been really great. All right, so Erik, I'm curious about like how you started. What was your inspiration? Was this a something you just innately needed to do?
Yeah, it's not a choice.
Yeah.
It's not a choice. It's a compulsion. The impetus after retiring was keep the geezer busy.
Oh, for sure.
And be engaged in entertaining. So far, so good. Entertaining.
Right, hey, it's all good. As long as it stays up, we're happy.
and staying entertained with, creating a, and developing a discipline that was different than my life's work, but making it also relate to what I was doing. So, it was to continue ideas that had started in the late 60s and 70s and incorporate some of the stuff from architecture and art direction from film into those and, just stay engaged.
So what you said, one of the things earlier that I thought was super interesting, and that is the idea that as an architect, like you have to quote unquote draw things right. Right? It has to be a right box. It has to be a right, like, it has to be right. And so, in your work, the goal is not necessarily to be right, but to be outside of that.
Outside of right is good, yes. So much of the world doesn't quite make sense. And so I'm trying to keep consistent with that notion. So the work has surprises in it, or the work has illogical spaces in it. It's kind of a look at how the world is.
Illogical?
Illogical.
For sure. I think that's
interesting.
More prevalent. Not right, right. Yeah, something to
colorful
look at.
And illogical.
And so illogical. Yeah.
That's really the impetus for a lot of this. And it's the process, I think I told you earlier, that it's a process of trying to make all those different disciplines develop into a dialogue with each other and with perception of space and all that kind of stuff. It's all related, but unrelated.
Right. So when we were talking about that earlier, talking about the fact that you create pieces like this, which are multi-dimensional and could be considered sculpture. We have some other pieces I'll show you guys later that are definitely like more 3D sculpture, but then you're also been working in photography and paint. And so when you're talking about building that relationship between all of these mediums so that they have a conversation.
Right, they have a conversation. They have they shared ideas and then ideas that are only be expressed in their particular type of space. There's things in the sculpture that where color is and how it develops that has to do with relationship of bits in space, relationship of how things come together, and then where colors come from. In the paintings, it's about creating these just initially line drawings that are not necessarily going to be correct in any way. There'll be things that are similar to correctness, but then there'll be things that are just outside of that, and setting up that surprise or setting up that challenge to what we consider norms is kind of an important part of the work.
Yeah. So you've had the pleasure of doing a lot of different things, working in a lot of different areas of that have kind of all led to where you are now.
Absolutely.
Right? Because you're talking about how you want to be able to bring in all of those aspects of what you've done,
right,
to create these conversations. So tell us about some of those things that you've done.
Well, I worked in film as an assistant art director in the beginning and then art director towards the end of my time there. And then following that, I worked as an architect. And in those instances, both those cases, I had to make drawings that and or models or whatever that made sense, where the space did work as it needed to work, and that were not necessarily we're necessarily not creating any ambiguities, but we're supporting, kind of anonymously supporting the actors in the space that they needed to be in. And these are just the opposite in some ways. They're trying to not support the space that we normally
work in. So they're a little resistant to this space.
A little resistant, yeah. A little really resistant to our expectations.
Right.
Yeah.
Which makes them interesting, because that's kind of that's what draws the eye, is something that's maybe not quite right.
It, for me it is. It's something that that really challenges the viewer, and for the most part I'm the viewer. That challenges me in the process is to create space that almost makes sense, but then it maybe changes in some way. Some just flip into a different space entirely, like some of the optical illusions, and some of them are more subtle, where the space is layered, but some of the stuff in the middle or in the foreground is actually in the background, or what looks like a plane has twisted and is not a plane anymore. All those different things that our expectations are setting us up and then surprising us, or allowing that to be part of it.
So we were talking earlier, and you shared this quote with me, so I definitely want you to share it with our audience as well.
So this is a quote. A couple weeks ago, my cousin sent me this book by Natalie Goldberg, and it's three simple lines. It's about haiku and her pilgrimage through the world in pursuit of it. And there's a quote in here. I guess she took a class from Allen Ginsberg. And this quote, when I read it, I went, oh, damn, that's a lot like what I'm doing. So I think there's a relationship between these pieces and haiku, the form of haiku. And it's... this is the quote from Ginsberg. The only real measure of a haiku is upon hearing one, your mind experiences a small sensation of space.
Yeah.
And that's really it.
I like that.
All of a sudden you're given an opportunity
to fill space.
To fill a space. And then to have it challenged immediately. So let's see, there's more. Bear attention. No distraction, pure awareness, noticing only what is in the moment. Being connected to seasons, unconnected to self-clinging, and then out of that, composing your experience in three lines that go beyond logic. So.
That's awesome. I think I'm going to have to get that book. It seems like, have you enjoyed the book as a whole?
Yeah, I'm about two-thirds of the way through it. And I'd say probably late middle age. Zen student, and she travels the world, and a writer, and she travels the world getting to know the Roshis.
Ah, that's very cool. That's very cool.
Yeah.
So what are your next steps?
That's interesting. I think we just continue on. I'm always trying to work in unfamiliar territory, challenging myself to take risks that often fail. And I recently had a visit from some curators who were challenged by my work to the point where they didn't even want to look at it. They liked the 3D stuff, they didn't like the paintings, and I figured it was, I couldn't really get a sense of what it was, but they didn't want to look at it. And it was interesting because, you know, I started in the late 60s and early 70s, and hard edge was really part of what was happening. And
sure.
So, you know, when I was painting back then, I then went to work because I had to, and I had to quit painting, and I'm just picking up where I left off. And then
pause, right?
Yeah.
Like literal.
Yeah. And then incorporating the stuff that I learned along the way as part of it, in response to where I was before. So maybe it's not fashionable right now to be working hard edge. That's okay. So one of the things I've been contemplating is playing with these in a more relaxed, painterly fashion, which may be interesting. It may be a success, or it may be a failure.
Fair enough.
So that's the direction.
I like that direction.
It should be.
I like the ability to take a risk and be okay if it doesn't actually work out.
Yeah, it's fine. You know, it's just like, it's an opportunity. You know, I really saw that lack of interest as an opportunity for me to challenge what it was I was doing and see if there was maybe more I could in a direction that would still do what I'm doing, but make it less out of date.
Well, and that's a hard thing. I mean, we kind of talked about that earlier, though, that, you know, that every artist's work isn't going to be for everybody.
Exactly.
Or for every curator or for every museum or gallery. Like, it doesn't really work that way, right?
No.
Like, you create things that are pleasing to you.
Right.
And hopefully somebody else will find them pleasing as well.
Hopefully.
Right?
That's not the impetus, though. The impetus is to keep the gizzard busy.
Right. Keep the gizzard busy.
Yeah. You know?
I love that.
Yeah. You know, and to engage stuff that was part of all those, you know, while doing a set for a movie, some things would occur, and I would, you know, think, yeah, let's file that. It may be something that I can use later.
Right, yeah.
So,
note to self.
Yeah.
Hey, that worked out kind of good.
Yeah, or, you know.
Or don't ever do that.
Yeah. Or what if we did this to it, and, you know, all that kind of stuff. So,
right.
Yeah.
Right.
It's a process, and I think that's the really important part. And I'm not sure if that's fashionable either. And, you know, just like when I was an architect, people would have their latest pictures from Dwell or House or whatever it was, and that would be, you know, what they wanted to do, say with their kitchen and dining room. And I would say, well, you know, you can chase fashion, but, or you can just make a really nice space.
Right.
And maybe we should just make a really nice space. And often they'd come around, and it was always more successful.
Yeah. Well, and that, I mean, to me in those situations, it makes sense, because what I don't want to be doing is remodeling every 10 years to keep up with fashion.
Yeah, it's just not reason.
Right? I mean, I can paint to keep up with fashion.
Yeah.
But the structure, right?
If it works.
The space
needs to
work no matter what color I choose, no matter what decor I place on it or in it or around it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I agree. With that.
It was interesting. It was an interesting process, and it was sometimes in that the source of the frustration with their space and the to change it was based on, well, they hadn't seen anything like it in any of the magazines, so they thought it was wrong. And then, you know, we have to be right, and it's like, oh, God, this, why is it not working?
That's interesting. We are so manipulated by what is presented to us.
Yeah.
Right?
Whatever's on the fashion plate that day.
Correct. Yeah.
And it's so quickly changing that you just can't keep up, and why bother?
Right. And I feel like it used to not be that way. I feel like things stayed the same for a little bit longer, but now I feel like everything is rotating so quickly.
You think it's because of what the amount of information is accessible?
Yeah. What's available to us?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a lot of different.
It's just flying out.
Yeah.
Way faster.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It makes it hard to settle.
Yeah, so it's really easy then to, okay, present yourself with your own situation like these works, and to present yourself with, well, these are things that I'm doing here, what's the next step in that process, and really settle on that as a direction, and, you know, all of that. And so I really feel like I'm developing a vocabulary in these works in terms of a vocabulary that defines space in a certain way. And so, okay, this one does space this way, this one does that way. What are the things that are positive about those? And then where's the next place I can take it? And then where's a place where I can take it that maybe is completely separate from that?
Right.
And that's part of the impetus for doing the photos as well as the paintings, because then those things really relate to each other in terms of things that can happen with photos that are so different than things that can happen with paint.
Definitely unexpected.
Unexpected relationships, and those often inform each other, which is it's really fun.
Yeah,
really fun.
I agree with that. I think that is, especially the way that you're pulling your photos together and the collage, like, I feel like that can definitely create, can translate even here.
It's very similar.
Yeah, I see, yeah, because it does have a similar feel, but because they're photographs, the hard edges, right, those hard lines,
mm-hmm.
are slightly blurred,
yes.
and softened. So where they definitely relate to your work here, there is that kind of maybe next step different.
Right, exactly.
It still relates, but it has a very different feel.
Right.
Even though it's a similar feel.
Yeah, you have a photo in space, and you have a whole perspective that's in that photograph that then challenges the space that you're seeing as just if it was just a color plane.
Right.
I think this one behind me does that. I think the gray area with the wood colored line kind of erodes that plane that's there and takes it into a realm that doesn't exist. It can't exist.
Right.
There's a friend, a guy that's been a painter all his life, and he's in his 80s, I think. And his response to this piece was, I see you're still making spaces that can't exist.
That's the plan, thank you very much.
Yes.
So thank you for noticing.
Yeah, it's really cool. That was perfect. That was actually perfect.
Yeah, you're like, thank you.
Yeah.
That's my plan.
He's a sweet guy. Yeah, so, there we are.
Yeah. So I like the direction that you are going. So let's talk about maybe what advice you would offer. So you've had the opportunity to kind of work with some young artists, right? So
yeah.
What is the, like, how do you, inspire them? How do you... direct
yeah.
them.
Mm. Well, enjoy what you're doing. That's number one. I think pay attention to what has been done and what is happening. Don't consider one superior to another. Read what people have said about their work. I think it was either Jasper Johns or Rauschenberg was talking about when he first started doing what he was doing, people were doing all kinds of stuff that was that was important to realize. I mean, it's been important to me that that's a bad quote. It wasn't a quote. It was just kind of a notion. And but it's a very important component of where I've kind of developed this work. Just follow what's interesting to you. Be influenced by it. Understand what people are doing. Understand what they've done in the past. And I, also a component of that for me is really take it out of time.
Mm-hmm.
Let yourself work where you're working and see what there is there. Investigate it. See how many things you can find that are related to but different than, and pursue that.
So take a step back.
Yeah, it's
look
really
look at your stuff.
Yeah, look at your stuff and enjoy it and see what you're doing and understand what you're doing. And you know, this book that came 2 weeks ago was, and reading what Ginsberg said about haiku was really something that resonated with me. And this work I've been doing for quite a few years now, pushing a decade, and so. It was interesting to see, yeah, maybe there's other things that relate. And that's, I think that's important too. When I worked in film, a lot of what I did was go to create things that were relevant to a set or to a vehicle or to whatever it was I was designing, would be go to a different discipline, go to something that was happening that was not related to what I was, and see how I could adapt that to relate to what it was that I was doing.
Right.
And that was always fun to see, again, how you could take differences and coalesce them into something that was relevant to whatever it was you were doing. And it was something that actually got me jobs. People would say, production designers would tell me, you know, the reason I wanted you around was because you do that. You find things that we're familiar with, that are commonplace, but we're not using them in a specific way, and you bring it into the space, and then it's really interesting because it's used, and it's something that we relate to, but we've never seen it used that way before.
Right. So you find, because in that, I hear challenge.
It's gotta be there. Yeah. It's gotta be there. Otherwise it's boring. And boring is boring. It's boring to you, it's boring to the person that's looking at it. The boring person that's using it. So
and challenge might mean failure.
It does, often.
Yeah.
And you know, there were a lot of movies I worked on where at the beginning there was a budget of whatever for the art department, and By the end of our preliminary design, the budget had been cut by 50%, and so all of a sudden everything had to shuffle. And so that's just a component of life in the world, you know.
You got to make what you had planned to do with a certain amount work the same with less.
Yes, and then, you know, that's a component of architecture as well. It was a long time ago, 20 years ago, something like that, all of a sudden the cost of building doubled and tripled in less than a year, and the structural engineer that I worked with for years told me that he had done the engineering for a building for UC Riverside. And that when they got bids, it took about a year and a half to design it. And when they got bids and get it through City Hall. And the bids came in and they couldn't afford it. So they looked at the budget and they said, well, we have to cut 30% out of it. And that meant downsizing the building and still, you know, keeping the program so that it would address the needs of the user. And so they had to downsize the building by 30%. they should have said downsize it by 60%, because when they got it redesigned, got it back through City Hall, and then got bids, it was the same price as the original building, because cost of construction was going nuts. So these are realities.
Oh, yeah.
These are realities that always are part of the
factor in.
Yeah, they're part of the whole component system of it. So yeah, you just extrapolate from that and figure that in the processes things will change. Mm.
And sometimes pleasantly.
Yeah, sometimes.
Yeah.
And often, you know, like right now it seems like I spend a lot of time looking at work online and in hanging in space, and excuse me, it seems the fashion right now in painting especially, and sculpture as well. If you look at Frank Stella's recent sculpture, it's just busy, which is really different than his normal stuff from the 60s. And you look at the work of most of the painters these days, most of them that are just sort of all over the internet, and it's really busy, and the space is really not necessarily consistently intentionally contradictory. It seems to be a collage, a mishmash, just a bunch of stuff thrown at the, a bunch of images thrown together on the canvas, and I really think that often stepping back from that and finding some simplicity, you know, you can find within any of those, you can find some really nice parts of it, some really beautiful areas. And I think that's always, I think that for me anyway, that's a bonus when I find in a piece that I've done a chance to edit and to simplify and still have maybe a clearer statement, even if it's illogical.
Right. Well, it's okay. I mean, a statement is a statement, whether it's logical or not logical,
right.
Still a statement.
Yeah. So.
So that's interesting. I find that to be true as well, as I, you know, look and see kind of what is going on. And it does seem that a lot of things are busy and a little chaotic. And I wonder if that is not just a representation of kind of where we're at in space
sure.
and time right now, right?
I think it is, yeah.
Is things kind of feel a little
very,
chaotic.
Very chaotic. And so that's fine, but maybe we need a respite from that.
Oh my gosh. Yes, we do.
and
maybe that's going to be part of kind of what happens too in the next several years, is that there'll be a desire to simplify and clean it up, so to speak. You know?
I think so. I mean, that's part of my emphasis for doing the work that I do, is to keep it real simple.
Right.
Not to make it boring, but to keep it simple.
Well, simple doesn't have
and,
to be boring.
You know, I think there's a really nice juggling contest there between keeping it clean and simple and interesting. I think that's a really nice challenge. And it's part of the components of what I'm trying to drag into the work is, okay, there is logic to the space, but it is confounded by illogical notions, but there is a simplicity that allows a person to understand it if they want to take the time to understand it.
Right.
And some of the stuff I see these days is just cacophonous. Mm-hmm. And I can't find a logic, which maybe isn't important, but I think the difference is sometimes it's like when a dog or a little kid just kind of pounds on the piano keys, it's just cacophonous. And I think, you know, they may get lucky once in a while and hit something that's fun, but for the most part, it's just noise.
That's a good statement, though. I like that, because when, when I'm looking at these, because, you know, music relates to art
right.
as well as, you know, the way that the colors vibrate and sound. And, so it makes sense that you would even use that term as banging on a, you know, piano, because as you were saying that, I can picture in my mind what a picture might look like.
Yes.
As a child is banging on.
Yes.
A piano.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Versus a beautiful melody, or, you know, yeah, like that. It has a totally different response.
Yes. Yeah. There's a. It's completely different. There's a. I can't remember what the term is for that, but seeing color and then hearing sound. There's the guy that was the realtor for our house that sold the house in LA. I had one of my paintings up that was called Jazz Piano, and it was pretty hard edge, but still very geometric. And he sang in choirs and stuff like that. And Matt was looking at the piece, and he started making sounds because he was hearing sounds from the work.
Yeah.
And I don't hear sounds from the work, but I definitely get a lot of images that start pushing me in directions, which is
right. Fun. Yeah. It's a beautiful thing. Yeah. Like there's so much to it.
Yes.
Right?
Well, I think that's also part of the simplicity is allowing that notion of there's so much to it to be a part, and to give people the time to really kind of sit back with the piece if they're so inclined, let it wash over them, let the different relationships, I mean, that's what I do, and it's not because, ooh, wow, look at that, it's like, oh, that's very interesting. That's very nice. That makes me feel a certain way. It's
right. And let me observe it.
Yeah.
Right? What else is there? There's more,
there?
Right?
There's more.
So there's already a trigger. So now what else is there? So let me observe it. Let me absorb it. Let it wash over me. Let it, tell me what it needs to say.
Yes. And some of the pieces reveal over time that aren't. It's not really a complexity, but they aren't necessarily going to show you all the different levels instantaneously. And
right, which is, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I mean, as an observer, it keeps you coming back. It's like, what am I going to find next?
Yeah. And
what is it going to say next time?
Yeah, we talked about color relationships before and those kinds of things. Time of day, quality of the light. All of that stuff plays
changes
into
the story.
It. Yeah, it changes the story. It shifts it, and it shifts the feel. And so,
yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah, it's fun. It's really fun. And in the process of keeping it as simple as possible, allows me to understand those qualities and understand those opportunities are there to see it again, to see it in a different way, and to be able to remember what that other way was and how it relate to what's happening now. I like the work, I like to do the work, I like the process of doing the work, and I like visiting the work from time to time and seeing what else it reveals.
So do you ever come back after a piece is done and feel like you need to change it?
Really.
Yeah.
It usually beats on me to the point where
I don't stop until it's done.
Yeah, that kind of thing.
And then I don't ever want to look at it again.
No, not that. It's just. I think it's really, a piece could never be done, and I think it's really important to say
True.
That it is, and to say, okay, if I want to change something with it, once it works. I think it works. And then if I want to change something with it, looking at it with new eyes and saying, okay, it taught me this.
Mm-hmm.
What's next?
Right.
How can I take that and develop the next bit? And I think that's really another important component.
I agree. Yeah, what did I learn doing that piece?
Yeah,
and how do I apply that to the next piece or two pieces down the road,
Right, and it does leap.
Yeah.
Sometimes, there'll be things that were 10 years ago that will be showing up, and I go, oh. And, I can't remember where I read it, but probably about a decade ago, I was reading a biography, I think, of Picasso, and he was talking about one of the things that was a component of his process. And he kept sketchbooks around, and he would use them, he would open them wherever they opened, and he wouldn't make sure that the up was up and the down was down with what was in there. And some of the stuff he was working on was 2 or 3 decades old, and he would just open it where it opened and
work on that,
do a sketch in there or an idea, and develop an idea. And he talked about it as it gave him the opportunity that was not available with finished work. It gave him the opportunity to have this idea and this idea next to each other in a way that he wasn't necessarily going to put it together. They're physically next to each other in the book. And because they were spanning a length of time, those two ideas would facilitate developing a third idea or a fourth idea.
Right.
And he continued to do that. He didn't ever do it in sort
sequence.
No, he just opened up a sketch. So
that's awesome. That's a really good technique. I mean, even if I'm thinking about like a writer, right? Like you just open your notebook and you jot down
right.
a quote, a thought, of whatever.
Right.
And then eventually, like, gelling happens, right? Like things begin,
Something will come out of it.
Yeah.
Not every time.
No, that's okay.
Something will come out of it, and it will be probably needing some refinement.
Yeah, but that's okay, because all you need is the spark of the idea.
Exactly.
Right, you just need the spark.
Yep.
Yeah.
And like the work that I did where I would go to a different discipline and take something that was of that and stick it in another context, that really kind of, it's that process. It's that process of mining stuff, but maybe using it for more than just kind of repeating what's there, but to
expand
something else that you're working on. And it's not always consciously trying to do that. I think that's really important.
Yeah. Well, that's the idea of, like, if you're flipping through that, you're not consciously really looking for something to jump out at you, right? You're
right.
observing,
right.
like, this work, so to speak. And if something, but it can happen anywhere, right? In any
right.
book you're reading,
right.
in any walk you take,
right.
in any
exactly.
circumstance,
yeah.
right?
Yeah. And it's just being open to it. So again, back to the simplicity of some of the work is to allow that clarity to then be accessible and then allow it to be applicable to something else.
Right. So to be able to take it in and then reproduce it,
yeah.
so to speak.
Yeah.
Put it in space.
Yeah. Let it have a life.
Yeah. yeah.
Let it have a life. I think that's the other thing. And when I was in architecture, first, you know, it was a master's in architecture, it's a 3-year program, and the first couple semesters, people were trying to do a masterpiece. And professors often would say, you know, keep it simple, stupid, and really try to just allow the design to evolve itself. Be just there to facilitate what the design wants. And those were two really good approaches that they've really helped with everything that I tried in my career.
Yeah, slow down.
Slow down. Enjoy the process.
Mm-hmm.
Get more done faster.
Which is crazy.
Yes, well, except that it works, isn't it? It's
yeah.
more effective.
It is more effective, you're right. But it is interesting. And I think that it's in stark contrast to the world that we live in, too, which is all about like producing.
Hurry up.
Right? Hurry up.
What's taking you so long?
Right.
I'm paying you how much an hour for that?
Right. Right. It's like, whoa. Whoa.
Okay.
Yeah. Huh. Yeah. Better work comes from slowing down.
And often quicker.
And often quicker. Because you have to make less mistakes. Right.
So anyway.
This is great. So do you have any last words? We've been chatting a long time.
Mm. Enjoy the process.
Enjoy the process.
Enjoy the process. It's your life. It's the only one you get.
Yeah, make it a good story.
Here today, gone tomorrow.
Yeah. Boy, and we sure know that even more now. Huh?
Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you.